Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Projecting it more.
I think we need to start. It is time. The time has come, friends.
Good morning. Grab a seat, everyone, and we just thank you for coming today. It was a beautiful morning. Let's just open up in a quick prayer, Lord. Lord, we just thank you for this morning. We just thank you for you. And we praise you because you're worthy to be praised. In Jesus' name, amen.
We welcome you to stay seated for the first song, and it's good to have Jenny and Scotia. Some of them confess to me it's their first time ever singing into a microphone in their life. So just all of you pretend that you have a microphone and you're singing into it to give us that extra courage today, okay? This song Scotia chose because it is her granny's favorite song. So she's going to start it off for us in honor of her granny. You to stand, and I want to tell you the story of the Bells on Christmas Day, which is a wonderful song. Where are the words? There's no words. Oh, I'm so sorry. That's why no one's singing along. I thought you just wanted to hear us singing. I'm so sorry. That is unfortunate. If you have your phones, get them out and look up the lyrics for I Heard the Bells on Christmas Day. Just take a minute if you have your phone. I'm so sorry. I wasn't aware. It's quite bright up here. I'm so sorry. I don't know if they're in the hymn books. I'm so sorry. So we're going to sing for you a lovely song. And this song was inspired by a man who was very discouraged during a time of war in the U.S. and the Civil War. And he just said, you know, he said, in despair, I bowed my head. There's no peace on earth. And I think in our time, it's so easy to just be like, you know, this is discouraging. And there have been times throughout all of history. We're reading a book right now by John Woolman, who was an abolitionist in the 1700s. All throughout history, people have felt the overwhelming burden of sin and brokenness in the world. But by the end of the song, it turns around and the bells are singing and God is not dead. Those of us that are here know that. So let us just sing it for you, and whatever words you can catch on, sing along and bless you. I'm so sorry. It's one of Birgit's favorite songs, so maybe let's take a minute and pray for peace to be with Bruce and Birgit as they're in a place that has different kinds of needs than us. Thank you, Lord, that you are the peace that we cannot find on our own, we cannot muster up on our own. We just trust you to continue to bring peace into our individual lives and into our communities, and especially with Bruce and Birgit today, and Leisha and Max. Amen. Our last song is God Rest Ye Merry Gentlemen. Lots of goodwill to you. So if you want, you can sit down and hear us sing it for you, because you don't have the words. We're happy to just sing this tiding of comfort and joy to you. Joy.
Lord, we just thank you for this time of singing and worship. And for those of us who know you, Lord, we hear these songs and we praise you, and we wonder what would we be without your salvation? Or who would we be without your salvation even? Lord, we just praise you and we thank you for Jesus Christ as the means of salvation to you. Amen.
Morning. I have the pleasure, while Birgit is away, of doing the call to worship for you all. So today is the third Sunday of Advent, and I'm a person that welcomes Advent into my life because it offers a time of reflection and expectation. And it's left me reflecting on Emmanuel, God with us. Matthew records the angel speaking to Mary, and he quotes Isaiah and says, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, God with us. Often folks will say that there are only two of the Gospels that record the story, the birth of Christ's story, but that's actually not true. There's three, Matthew, Luke, and John. John's is just extremely short, and you might miss it if you're not looking for it. It's found in 1 John, verse 14. And it says, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us," which means that God became man. If we jump back up to the beginning of John, so chapter 1, verse 1, it says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made." I am still a very newbie at studying Hebrew, but I can tell you that the word that's translated as the Word had more depth in the Hebrew language than it does in the English. It meant both word and deed. And we see this lived out of the spoken word and then the action in creation. "Let there be light," and there was light. All of creation was spoken, and then the deed or the action came. And Jesus lived the same way as he is the Word that became flesh. And so we see it in his life too. He said, "I am the resurrection and the life," and he raised Lazarus from the dead. He said, "I will feed these 5,000," and then he says, "I'm the bread of life." So in that reflection, it's left me thinking, where do my words and deeds line up, and do they? And what am I doing with this Emmanuel, God with us? Because if I'm to model my life after Christ, and he is the same God who spoke creation into being, and his words always matched his deeds, then do my words match, or do my words and my deeds match his? Do I know and do I obey his word? And so that's my prayer for all of us this morning, that not only will our deeds match our words, but that our deeds will match his words. So let me pray for all of us. Emmanuel, you truly are God with us. We thank you that you left your throne and came to earth to walk among us, to show us how the same power that spoke creation into being could be lived out as a human, that what we say and what we do can be modeled after your word. And so I pray that, Lord, for each of us this day, that we would know and obey your word, and that our deeds would not only reflect our words, Lord, but most importantly, that they would reflect yours. Amen.
Thank you, Cheryl. Boy, we know how much we miss Bergen and Bruce when we don't have any announcements here, we don't have the music here, but they do so much for us, and I guess this is better than everything went perfect without them. We didn't miss you at all, Bruce. No, everything went perfect. No, just a little hiccups, but that's okay. So we don't have the announcements up here, but I do have a few that I wrote down this morning before coming, so if I miss any, just let me know, okay? So there's Wednesday morning. Bruce used to have this every Wednesday morning, a coffee here, a time of prayer. Viv took over this past week, I believe, and she's going to continue that for the rest of the month. How many people showed up, Viv? Ah, fantastic. Okay, so on Facebook Live, you can join on 7 o'clock in the morning on Wednesday. So we're going to have an Eve of Christmas Eve service. So then the 23rd, we're going to have it here. I don't know more details than that, but, and we do. Sorry? And that's at 7 p.m., Eve of Christmas Eve here. And we'll get more details as we get closer. And you know what? It is December 12th, and we are getting closer. It's just creeping up on me. I don't know. I don't know about you guys, but Christmas is creeping up here. But we'll get some news out. Please look at the announcements that Shelley puts out every week. But it's going to be the 23rd here at 7 p.m. For Youth for Christ, we have a Jesus birthday bash on December 17th, just across the street at the Kin. Am I mistaken? We're good. Is there anything else going on with the Youth for Christ things coming up? Again, just check with the announcements that Shelley brings out. So birthday, Jesus' birthday bash, December 17th, next Friday, just across the street. The Care and Share, the FAST has let me know that even though on the announcements it says they might be going outside for a fire, it's kind of old, they're not going outside anymore, so they're staying inside, and they're going to be starting it up again in January sometime, and just look for the news for that. Is that correct? And next week, so the United Church has informed us that they're going to be using the hall a little bit after their service. So we come in after they leave, but next week they're going to be doing a little, I guess, a Christmas thing just in the service. So we're still able to hang our jackets there and do things, but just be cognizant that they're there and we can be quiet as we do it, and we don't bother too much when they're in their hallway, the hall down there. There will be Sunday school next week, though, still. So we're good with that. So just for next week. COVID protocols, I think we got it drilled in our head. I think we're good, maybe, I hope. But we don't have the announcement, so I can't point to that. But masks are good. And that's it. Anyone else has a, yeah, Viv? Okay, so just, yeah, Isabel? Okay, so let's put this all together here. So there's still going to be a Christmas gift exchange. It's happening today and next week. Is that correct? Today's a drop-off day. Okay. Okay, so the ones that are outside right now, okay. So no one go in there, don't take anything, okay? Okay. Yeah, we thought it was for today for the gift exchange, but that's okay. If it's not there today, bring it next week. Yeah, Francesca? Sorry, I didn't catch it. It was two birthdays this week. So Ryan and Oh, and Steve. Okay, well, happy birthday, guys. And Henri, too. Hey, Henri. And I think that... And Henri has his birthday as well today. We mentioned that. Okay, and I think we're done. So, yeah, so the gift exchange thing, give it to Vivian if you don't have it today by Wednesday at the motel, okay? And next week we'll distribute it. So now we can ask the kids to leave, if you like, for 2 to 7 years old junior church. Is there one? Yeah. Is there? Yeah, okay. Just making sure. Ah, we need Bergen and Bruce back, eh? All right, so this is the time that we go with a corporate prayer, and if there's any prayer requests, I have I've written down a couple from last week. Celine and Neil, they're going through cancer treatments, and Celine has finished her treatment, so we can continue praying for her and that they recover well. Is there anything else? Okay, I'm sorry, I just wrote down what I read, so. So she hasn't finished her treatment, so sorry. She still has 2 more after this, so okay. But she finished her first set of treatment, I presume. That's what it meant? Okay. Continue praying for them anyways. Is there anything else? Yeah, Mary. So Mary's has a friend, Mike, you said, Connie and Mike, you said, but it's Mike who's going under treatment, and he's going through some intensive treatments every few days, it seems like that, right? Every day, wow, okay. Wow, so the treatments are every day for 3 weeks, break, and do it again for 3 weeks. Wow, that's huge, so we can pray for Mary's friend, Mike, who's going under a cancer treatment. So the prayer request is for Jennifer's dad, who's been going through some treatments to increase his red blood cell productions in his bone marrow. And we can pray for those success of those treatments coming up. And Isabel and then Brett. Isabel is requesting prayer for the teachers and the students who are undergoing a stressful time for exams during this time of the year. First Brett and then Alex. Brett? The prayer request was for the less fortunate than us who don't have a home or meals or anything at this time of the year, any time of the year, but this time of the year is particularly more acute, if you will. So Danica Reed, just, I don't know if this is news to everyone, but she was walking home from work, I believe, or she was walking home, and there was, she got hit by a truck and on the ditch, and apparently a car found her and brought her to the hospital. She went to Ottawa Hospital in Ottawa, but she's back home now, so that's an answer to prayer for those initial, I think she's back home from what we understand. There was a bunch of prayers going out immediately after it happened, but we got to continue to pray for her because the situation is still serious. Okay, so we'll just bow our heads and we'll just bring these things up to the Lord. Our Father, you've heard our request. You know there are people who are needy. You know there's always will be people who are needy, Lord, but Lord, this is a season that we can proclaim your salvation through Jesus, Lord. And that's the only hope that we can give people that's everlasting. And Lord, we just pray for the people who are going through sicknesses now, the people who are going through stress for school. We just pray that not only can we be there to support their physical needs and their immediate needs, Lord, that we get opportunities to give, provide for their eternal needs as well. And now as we enjoy our brother Mark, who comes and will preach or talk to us or teach us about the scriptures, Lord, that we receive him. And as a brother in Christ, Lord, we're eager to hear him. And Lord, we just pray that that you can calm him and he can have a good memory to his words that he wanted to say, Lord. And we just thank you for the people who are willing to serve. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Reuben. And surprise, if you're expecting Pastor Bruce, you won't see him for another 3 weeks. So it's my privilege and honor to be here this morning to share with you what the Lord's laid on my heart. And I'd just like to open with a quick word of prayer, please. Just join me with your heads bowed and eyes closed. Holy Spirit, we recognize your presence amongst us in this place, surrounding your people. And Heavenly Father, I would ask that if there's anything that I speak that's not of you, that you would strike it from the minds and hearts of your people. Heavenly Father, this morning we bless your name. Jesus, we bless your name. Holy Spirit, we bless your name. Amen. So there are two things that God has exalted above all things. Who knows what those two things are? Do you know what one of them is? Two things that God has exalted above all things. One of them is, that's a good one, but no, love was the answer. So don't say love again, but love is a characteristic of Jesus, definitely. I saw a hand at the back. His name. That's one. 50% chance to get the next one. Who wants to take a go at it? Good job, John. He's exalted his name and Elijah, his son. No, but yes, he did. Renee Auer at the front. Sits at the front of the class. He said it. His word. Well done, Renee. Psalm 138, verse 2. This is King David bowing down and praising the Lord. He says, I will bow down towards your holy temple and will praise your name for your love and faithfulness. For you have exalted above all things your name and your word. His name and his word. Think about this for a second. His name. God has blessed his name above all things. This is how and why I love one of the men in our Next Level Men's Ministry group. He always closes his prayers in a certain way. And Arnold Reimers has given me permission to share this with you this morning. And it's inspired me and taught me. And if you ever get the chance to hear Arnold pray, he will always say this at the end of his prayer. We bless your name, God. Amen. So many people in this world misuse and abuse God's name and the name of Jesus Christ. And we as his church, as his people, need to bless God's name. We need to honor it, revere it, respect it, and fear it, and definitely use it properly in prayer, praise. But I'm actually not here this morning to talk about that, but that's a good lead into it. I'm here to talk about the second item that God exalts above all things, and that's his word. But before I do that, I want to share with you right now my conclusion, just in case you nod off. This is taken, if anybody's around my age, you were in high school in 1986, 87, there was a Christian band called Whiteheart that I listened to. Some of you know where I'm going with this. They had a song with a really neat title, and this is my conclusion. I'm going to take their title, their song. Simply this. Read the book. Don't wait for the movie. So now that you know my conclusion for today's message, let's start. Turn with me, please, in your Bibles. God's Word, 2 Timothy 3, verses 10 to 17. 2 Timothy 3, verses 10 to 17. And I'm going to ask that you stand with me in God's presence as we read this together. 2 Timothy 3, verses 10 to 17. Second Timothy 3, verses 10 to 17. And if you don't have your Bible with you, just follow along and listen as we read it out loud together. You, however, know all about my teaching, my way of life, my purpose, faith, patience, love, endurance, persecutions, sufferings, what kinds of things happened to me in Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra. The persecutions I endured. Yet the Lord rescued me from all of them. In fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted, while evil men and impostors will go from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learned it. And how from infancy you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are available to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. May God add his blessing and understanding to the reading of his word this morning. Thank you. You may be seated. In the first nine verses that we didn't read in 2 Timothy 3, Paul had just finished warning Timothy about godlessness in the last days. And if you ever wanted a summary of what situation our present world is in, just read those first nine verses that we didn't read together. The characteristics and personality traits of people described are the results of spiritual warfare. It's the unseen battle in the world around us today. Yes, due to sin in humans, we naturally move away from God and holiness towards all those sinful patterns that are outlined in the first nine verses. But what drives this continued displacement from our right relationship with God is our own spiritual apostasy and our own neglect of pursuing righteousness. And that's largely due, in fact, to the spiritual warfare that's waging around us by Satan and his demons. His agenda is to convince everyone that all you need to do is love yourself more. That's the spirit of this generation, of this age. And that's the complete opposite of what Jesus teaches. I've seen an increasing amount of alliance with evil practices and unholy behavior and attitudes around me in the last few years. I'm sure you have too. And Paul saw it too in his day and age, and he warns Timothy about it. And that brings us to verse 10. You, however, know all about my teaching, my way of life, my purpose, faith, patience, endurance, persecutions, sufferings. Paul's saying, Timothy, look at my life to see how to live like Jesus, to be a true Christ follower. But also, know this, Timothy, and know this, church, there is a cost. It's not easy being a Christ follower, especially in a world full of spiritual warfare, in a world where God's name is used carelessly in unholy ways, and where his word is treated with even more contempt. Paul goes on in verse 12 and says, in fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Basically, folks, you put a target on yourself when you choose to take a stand for Jesus. You walk into a battlefield of spiritual warfare every day with the crosshairs on you. And make no mistake, you will do this alone. Of course, you'll have the Holy Spirit with you. But you will face the world and Satan's empty philosophical lies by yourself. You will be mocked. You will be confronted. You will be put down, insulted, laughed at, and in trouble from society. Maybe even humiliated and embarrassed. But I would rather have that than the alternative. Verse 13 outlines what the alternative is. Evil men and imposters go from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. And I see this more and more every day as well. People don't want to hear the truth about God. Churches are watering down the theology of sinful humans in need of salvation. Christian schools are blending the worldly, which is basically satanic, philosophy of self-love as the way to save yourself. They're blending that with the truth of the Bible. It's all empty, hollow, ungodly teachings. Do not be deceived. So, how do you know? How do you make sure that you're not being deceived? Read the book, God's Word. Read the Bible. Get in the Word of God and know it. Verse 14, Paul's challenge and encouragement to Timothy and to us today. But as for you, Timothy, as for you, church, continue in what you have learned and have become convinced of. I'm going to check back on one chapter to 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 12 to 13, explaining that reference of what Paul has become convinced of, and likewise what Timothy has become convinced of, and the domino effect, what we have become convinced of. It says this, 2 Timothy 1, 12 to 13, I am not ashamed because I know whom I have believed and am convinced that he is able to guard what I have entrusted to him for that day. What you heard from me, keep as the pattern of sound teaching with faith and love in Christ Jesus. So, Timothy, and us, stay the course in the truth of the original gospel message about Jesus Christ. Do not be swayed or deceived otherwise. To do this, one needs to know the book. One needs to know the Word of God. Read the book. Paul says in verse 15, a reminder, Timothy, church, the Holy Scriptures are able to make you wise through faith in Christ Jesus. This world needs some more godly wisdom, and we do too in our individual lives. So we know how to address the issues and deceit that's around us every single day. Psalm 119, verses 98 and 99 says this, your commands make me wiser than my enemies, for they are ever with me. I have more insight than all my teachers, for I meditate on your statutes. The only way we can do that, friends, is if we read the book and we know what the statutes are. Verse 16, Paul outlines how the Scriptures can make us wise And this is where I want to camp out for a little while this morning. It says this, all Scripture is God-breathed. The whole Bible is God's holy, inspired, and unerring word. Cross-reference 2 Peter 1, verses 20 and 21, which says, above all else, you must understand that no prophecy came about by the prophet's own interpretation. For prophecy never had its origin in the will of men, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. The Bible is God's unerring word. He guarantees that. He spoke it to us. He wants us to know what the message is he has for our lives and how we are to live our lives. And if you don't accept all of what the Bible says, then you cannot call yourself a Christian this morning, my friend. If you do not follow what the Bible says, then you cannot call yourself a disciple of Jesus Christ. For the rest of this message, I'm just going to outline briefly what I plan to do. I'm going to outline four areas of our lives that will be brought into right relationship with God if we are regularly reading the Bible. I'm going to pause at the end of each of them for 1 minute of prayerful, silent meditation so that you and Holy Spirit can sort out each area of your life. And I don't mean for a second that you can solve all your issues in the world in 1 minute meeting with the Holy Spirit. But this is the beginning of what I hope will continue into the rest of the afternoon for you, maybe the rest of the weekend, the rest of the week, the rest of this year, the rest of your life. Think of this as an opportunity to get right, or at least start getting right, in your walk of faith with God. So, the first area of our life, all Scripture, it says, is useful for teaching. That's right learning for us. We can learn the right way through reading the Bible, God's Word. Do you want to know God better? Read the book. God reveals himself in his word. Do you want to know Jesus better? Read the book. God reveals himself in his word. Do you want to know the Holy Spirit better? Read the book. God reveals himself in his word. Do not listen to the teaching of this world because they will not include God. The teaching of this world has no hope. There's a song Casting Crowns sings called Only Jesus. And in that song, there's a line that goes like this. But all an empty world can sell is empty dreams. But listen to Hebrews 4, verse 12. The word of God is living and active. Sharper than a double-edged sword, it penetrates to dividing soul and spirit, joint and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. That's the kind of book I want to read. Who needs a movie? The Bible is living and active. As an English teacher of 28 years, I've read and studied a lot of books. Not one of them has the power and authority that the Bible has to change lives. That's including Shakespeare. He may make you think, but the Bible recreates your thoughts, transforms your mind, and realigns your attitudes for your heart and your life. The Bible teaches you how to live as God intended. No other piece of literature can do that. I'm going to turn on my stopwatch so I stick to the 1 minute time limit. Not yet. But I want to ask you to take a minute just now with your head bowed and eyes closed for the Holy Spirit to reveal to you, to teach you one aspect of yourself that needs to change or one aspect of Jesus that you need to adopt into your life and into your personality. I'm going to reread Hebrews 4, verse 12, as you meet with God for the minute of silent meditation that follows. I will not say anything for 1 minute. With your head bowed and your eyes closed, listen to the Word of God and allow the Holy Spirit to teach you this morning. Hebrews 4, verse 12. For the Word of God is living and active. Sharper than a double-edged sword, it penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. The second element of Scripture, when we read it and study it and know it, is that we will learn that all Scripture is useful for rebuking. And I call that the right attitudes, the right beliefs in our life. I go to my friend Merriam-Webster, the dictionary. To rebuke is to criticize sharply, to reprimand. It's an expression of strong disapproval. I liken this to the day-by-day, do-not-do type of learning that we will get from the Bible. The world will tell you to believe whatever you want. And if you're overwhelmed with all the choices, you're confused by worldly wisdom, and you're unsure of what to think and what to trust in during this life, read this book. It will reprimand you, and it will tell you what is unholy, what is ungodly, and what has no eternal value for your soul. Titus 1:13 speaks about rebellious people who are mere talkers and deceivers. It says this, therefore, rebuke them sharply so that they will be sound in the faith. How would Jesus evaluate your life this past week? Rebellious, talker of faith, but not living it. What about this last month? How would Jesus evaluate how you lived this last month, this last year? Deceiver, being deceived. I'm going to ask you to take the next minute to get real with God. Allow Holy Spirit, who's here with us today, to speak with you about your attitudes, about your beliefs. After I read to you this rebuke from Romans 12, verse 2. Close your eyes and bow your heads, please. I'll give you 1 minute after I finish. This is God's word, Romans 12, verse 2. Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing, and perfect will. we've heard about how all Scripture is useful for right learning, right teaching, how all Scripture is useful for rebuking, and now he continues, all Scripture is useful for correcting. Again, my friend Merriam-Webster, the dictionary, says, correcting is to make or set right, to counteract or neutralize a harmful tendency. And to put it more of a scriptural, spiritual sense, conforming to an approved or conventional standard or strict requirement of a specific ideology or set of beliefs or values. And guess what? This is God's world. He made you. He made the world. It's up to us to follow the standards that he sets. He made the rules. He made the norms. If you don't like it, you can make your own world. Let me know how that works out for you. The world will tell you there are no rules. Do what you want. But you know what? People who live like that quickly learn that they're in bondage to the world system because this world belongs to Satan. It is his realm. Not forever, but for this time period, it is his realm. Satan's rules, there are none. Live as you wish, but you will live unfulfilled. You will live without hope, and you will live always searching for something. God's rules, yes. He does set healthy parameters for us that gives us the freedom and the fulfillment because we live in that personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And that's what fills that God-shaped vacuum in your heart and your soul and your life. That's what every human being is looking for because that's what we were designed for. The Bible corrects wrong behavior and helps us align our life so that we can live more righteously. And by doing that, we will live more holy lives. Again, I'm going to take you to that point where you're going to meet with the Holy Spirit for 1 minute. I'm encouraging you to allow the Spirit to speak to you about God's grace in your life, that grace that enables you to conduct yourself in freedom while still living in an evil world. I'm going to read to you Titus 2, verses 11 to 14, with your heads bowed and your eyes closed. And then I'll give you 1 minute to meet with the Holy Spirit and listen to him. For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age while we wait for the blessed hope, the glorious appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, our God and Savior, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for himself a people that are his very own, eager to do good. All Scripture is useful for teaching. All Scripture is useful for rebuking. All Scripture is useful for correcting. And lastly, the last area of our life, all Scripture is useful for training in righteousness. Last time, we're going to Merriam-Webster.com. Righteousness is acting in accord with divine or moral law, free from guilt or sin. That's what I call the long-term living. the rest of your life. When you get to the end of your life, like Paul, you can say, I have run with perseverance. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Take one more minute to listen to the Holy Spirit speak to you, to encourage you, and cause you to praise God for your freedom in Jesus Christ. I'm going to read to you Romans 6, verses 19 to 23, which is our link to how all Scripture is useful for training in righteousness. Bow your heads and close your eyes, please. Allow the Holy Spirit to lead you as you hear the words of God. I put this in human terms because you are weak in your natural selves. Just as you used to offer the parts of your body in slavery to impurity and to ever-increasing wickedness, so now offer them in slavery to righteousness, leading to holiness. When you were slaves to sin, you were free from the control of righteousness. What benefit did you reap at that time from the things you are now ashamed of? Those things result in death. But now that you have been set free from sin and have become slaves to God, the benefit you reap leads to holiness, and the result is eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus, our Lord. My friends, read the book. To become more righteous, to become more holy, to become more Christ-like. To what end? What's the purpose? Paul tells us, verse 17, so that the man or woman of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Now, this is going to sound odd, but I want you to consider Elon Musk for a minute. Most of you have probably heard of him. The world's richest man on planet Earth right now. He spends billions of dollars, maybe trillions, in his SpaceX company to try to get humans to another planet. I think they're shooting for Mars. And the point is that they're going to live there for a little while. And you could argue that Elon Musk is doing a temporarily good thing. Granted. This morning, folks, I want to tell you that I want to be a Christian version of Elon Musk. And so should you. Consider the fact that we have unlimited wealth and power and resources in God. And our job is not to just get people to Mars. It's to get people to heaven, a whole new world, not to live temporarily, but to live for eternity. When you read the book, you are thoroughly equipped for every good work of eternal value. You are able to live up to the calling that God has put upon your life and to live in ever-increasing closeness with Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior. So that you and I might be able to represent him well. And so that we can all be Christian versions of Elon Musk and send people into the glorious kingdom of God to live forever, for all of eternity. May that be our legacy, church, to build the kingdom of heaven. In closing, I'd ask that you remember this. If I'm going into battle every day with a target on me and crosshairs on my mind and my heart, then I better go into battle with my sword in hand. The sword, the word of God in my mind and in my heart, so that it boosts my shield of faith, so that I might make it through to the next day to do battle again. Read the book, my friends. Don't wait for the movie. Please stand with me. Heavenly Father, we bless your name. Holy Spirit, we bless your name. Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, we bless your name. Your word is given to us, God, to teach us, to rebuke us, to correct us, and to train us in righteousness. We thank you for it. Thank you for loving us this much, Jesus. In your name I pray. Amen. And now, folks, it's up to you and the Holy Spirit, because you're going to go out into the world full of spiritual warfare. And your job is to represent him well. Go with God's grace and power upon you. Amen.